Welcome to the last presentation of today's, and yet another completely different topic. I come from the company that is developing and producing chromatography columns, more precisely monolithic columns, which are used for the purification, isolation, separation of biomolecules. And today I would present you maybe a small part when dealing with bacteriophages, entitled Strategies for Bacteriophage Purification Using These Metacrylate-Based Monolithic Columns. And to do this, I would go briefly through the introduction, not maybe so deeply into bacteriophages, because you know much more than I do on this field, but maybe some things about the chromatography itself, very superficially, just to get a grasp of it. Then I would like to present you the basic concept are the metacrylate-based monolithic columns, what they are, how they are made, what are the basic features, how they can be used for the separation of biomolecules, why they can be used for this. Then, since this is a bacteriophage in part conference, I would like to show you a case study, the purification of VDX10, a code name bacteriophage, and then maybe some conclusions. So to start with, bacteriophages, we know they can be used as delivery vehicles for DNA and protein vaccines. They can be used as phage display libraries for detection and identification of different bacterial strains, and more for treatment of antibiotic resistance, bacterial infections in medicine, in veterinary medicine, in food industry, and in agriculture, as we could hear in these previous days. So to do this, you probably need to have purified phage, especially for bio field, for using humans. You need to have purified phages and in a certain amount, grams or even more. And when you design the purification process, you need to have information, you need to have a robust upstream, and you need to have the knowledge about your sample. How does this sample behave before going to the purification? You need to have efficient purification methods, techniques, efficient chromatography columns, or different ways of doing purification. And you need, of course, to have the appropriate analytical methods. Otherwise, you are behaving like these two guys in the boxing ring because they don't know anything about upstream, about downstream. They don't know about the behavior of the phage, and then they are just saying, your sample was not good, my columns are good, and the other is saying, no, your columns are not good, my sample was okay, and the results are not good because of your fault. So we would like to avoid this. So to know the upstream and to know the downstream. I will be not touching upstream today, but more downstream applications. So virus purification can be done in different ways. One is so-called conventional techniques, like ultracentrifugation, incision chloride, or sucrose density gradient, or with some kind of selective precipitation, either ammonium sulfate, polyethylene glycol, and things like that. With this, you can generate amounts useful for laboratory work of your viruses or your phages, but these methods are, let's say, time-consuming, labor-consuming, and difficult to scale up to large scale. Chromatography is more and more the method of choice when you're trying to purify your viruses. And there are different ways of applying chromatography. One is site-specific gel filtration, or let's call it size exclusion chromatography. And you can also use this in your lab for the first-hand purification of your virus, because as a group-specific separation, it can be very efficient on a small scale. And just recently, but this is not the topic of today's presentation, Pete Gagnon from Validated Biosystems and his co-workers from Singapore presented a new type of chromatography, which they called constrained cohydration chromatography, which is something very, very interesting, it's just emerging. And hopefully this will be one of the very hot topics for the virus purification in the next weeks, months, or years. You can use hydrophobic specific, let's say hydrophobic interaction chromatography, pseudo-affinity like heparin, methylchelate, immune affinity, or in most of the cases, because they are the easiest to work with, charge-specific, anion exchange or cation exchange chromatography. So ion exchange chromatography, very briefly, is an adsorptive technique by which molecules are separated on the basis of the difference of the surface charge. Not only electrostatic interactions, but also non-electrostatic interactions contribute to the separations, but in most of the cases, we want to avoid this because these are unspecific. and they are causing problems to our separation. So we need to find ways how to avoid these non-specific interactions. We know that anion exchangers have a positive functional group, so they will bind negatively charged biomolecules, and vice versa for the cation exchangers. And majority of viruses will adsorb to anion exchange at neutral pH. But this is the same also for proteins and the toxins. They will also bind. So you need to have a kind of selective elution, linear gradient, stepwise gradient, then to separate these fractions, to separate your virus for proteins or surrounding impurities. For the cation exchange, at low pH, viruses can also absorb to cation exchanger, but then there is a problem of the virus stability at low pH. So this is seldomly used, only for some viruses. And luckily for us, some viruses also absorb at neutral pH to anion exchanger or cation exchanger, like influenza virus or some phages also. When they're bound to the crolum, you can do elution by increasing salt concentration or by changing pH. So with the salt concentration, you are displacing your virus. With pH, you are disrupting the net charge of the virus, and then there is no interactions with the stationary phase any longer. Just to show you two examples, which were done by Francis Maker in the early time when we started to work with phages, who is now at Jafral. You see, you load your phage sample on the column, impurities will not bind to the column under these conditions, and your phage will be eluted in the gradient condition, so when it will be substituted by sodium chloride. And of course, this UV profile will give you the profile not only of the phage, but also of some other impurities. So you need to collect this fraction and then maybe use some other methods to determine that this is actually your phage, plaque assay or some other. Weak anion exchanger, strong anion exchanger, and then you can go to strong cation exchanger, again do the linear gradient, but since this phage, this was a T4 phage, is stable at low pH, you can also try pH gradient. So you inject again your sample on the cation exchanger and do the pH gradient from pH 4 to pH 7, and you see that your phage is eluting at around pH 5. So then in the next step, you could combine these two techniques. Why? Because you can first load your sample with impurities and everything on the cation exchanger at pH 4. Most of contaminants will not bind then to these columns, only phage and some minor contaminants will bind. And then you can take this fraction and load it directly, because it doesn't contain salt, it's only at pH 7, you can load it directly to the anion exchanger. And then by this, you have an enhanced impurity depletion, so purer phage can be obtained. And the recoveries of phages from these columns are in the range of 60 to 80% in a single step purification. Very briefly about the difference between conventional and monolith chromatography columns. You are probably familiar with the fact that the conventional columns are packed with stationary phase, which are particle-based material, and mobile phase needs to run around these particles, and the molecules to be separated needs to protrude, need to diffuse into the beads. And these are always diffusion-limited processes. Diffusion is the main factor which is decreasing the speed of your separation. One practical example about the difference between diffusion and convective enhanced mass transfer is from every day. You are in the hurry in the morning to go to the, let's say, seminar, to the lectures, and you would like to have a cup of coffee. And you usually drink sweet coffee, so you need to add some sugar in the coffee. Now, if you would wait for this sugar to dissolve, because driven only by diffusion, you would probably miss most of the lectures that day. But if you take a spoon and mix it, then you do this as convectively enhanced, and this is much faster, and then you come in time at 9 o'clock for the first lectures in the morning. Because of these diffusion limitations, the binding capacity of your molecules will decrease because they will just not have enough time to penetrate into the beads. They will just go around, and you're losing the capacity, so the amount of the virus that you could bind to your column. And you also lose the resolution. So the separation is not as good as you would like it to be. Another challenge when you're dealing with viruses is the size of the viruses, because they're just too big. For the pores on the material, which are small, in the range of 100 or 300 angstrom, and then these particles which have a very high specific surface area act almost as non-porous particles, and then the capacity for binding your virus can be 100 times lower than it would be for proteins. This is maybe a picture which plastically shows this. All these gray circles in the pores, you see these small proteins which can penetrate into the pores and take the complete surface area which is available for the binding, but DNA and viruses, they're just too big and they will not enter into these pores. How can we overcome this? Of course, for this class of molecules, either changing the separation to membranes or to monoliths. And today, very briefly about methacrylate-based short monolithic columns. They are methacrylate-based polymeric monoliths with very large pore size. We don't call them pores any longer, we call them channels, which are from 1 to 6 micrometers, which is much, much larger than the size of the phages or viruses or molecules in question. Again, mass transfer diffusion, which can be very slow, or in this case, it's a convectively driven mass transfer, which can be much faster. And because of this convective transport, the flow-independent properties are there. The flow-independent properties means either you do the separation of abelian molecules in a low flow rate regime or a higher flow rate regime, you always get the same resolution. So you can increase your productivity, you can increase the throughput of your separations. This was done on, let's call them analytical, small-scale columns, but the same principle holds also for large columns in the industrial preparative scale. Separation on 8-milliliter column, 80-milliliter, or 800-milliliter columns, you always see the same resolution on different flow rates, different amounts of material loaded. It doesn't influence the resolution of the separation. So just briefly to summarize basic characteristics, basic features of this monolithic material. It has a high porosity. It means that the pressure drop because of this high porosity is lower. It means that you can preserve the infectivity, the activity of your sometimes labeled biomolecules, which can be, let's say, destroyed by shear forces in the chromatography columns. They are a very rigid material because they are highly cross-linked polymers. It means they are mechanically stable. It means you can go to high flow rates. It means you increase the productivity. And it means also they are made in a short layer. They are not long columns. They are very short columns. And then they can be easily scaled up by changing them from axial form to the radial form of shape. They have interconnected flow-through channels. It means they have high surface accessibility for large biomolecules, high binding capacity, and again, high productivity. Also, convective mass transfer, flow-independent properties, short process time, and this short process time results in biologically active compounds and high productivity. And they can be used for plasmid DNA separation, for DNA or virus depletion, for large protein separation, IgMs, for instance, endotoxin removal, and virus purification. And now in the next few slides, I would like just briefly to show you a so-called case study for this bacteriophage purification. This is the bacteriophage, which is directed towards Staphylococcus aureus. And it was by American company, Viridax Corporation, that are producing these phages, and they approached us to design a purification process for them because they needed this phage in larger amounts and high purity. More details can be found in this paper, which was published in 2010, and this phage is 80 nanometer head and 200 nanometers long tail. So incubation, this is upstream very briefly, infection with phages, centrifugation of the lyse culture, followed by filtration, and then you get your material, which can be directly loaded on the column for the column purification. During column purification, of course, the goal of every downstream processing is to have as much material, as pure material as possible, to keep the infectivity, so not to destroy the phage, and also the highest titer possible. Analytical methods that were used during this downstream processing were phage quantification using plaque assay methods, DNA with the non-specific method picogreen or with the qPCR, more specific, and proteins with Bradford, SDSPH was used, and Western blot and ELISA. Now, when you start to develop your purification process, you first usually start with buffer and stationary phase cleaning. And this can be done very quickly. You just take different buffers, in this case, sodium acetate at pH. So you cover a different pH range, 5.5, 7, 8.5. And then buffer B, because this is the ion exchange chromatography, it's the same buffer with sodium chloride. And you try different anion exchangers, different conditions, and you see that the highest recovery with these conditions used, you obtain with the QA, so with a strong anion exchanger, and with a phosphate buffer. So based on this, you go one step further, and you design a very simple Leiden gradient separation. You apply your lysate, which is treated, diluted in a way so that you get complete binding to the column. You dilute it, and then you load it on the column, and then you apply a linear gradient. And then you collect these fractions, which are impurities, your phage and DNA, and you need to show where your phage is present. And then based on this, with the plaque assay. Based on this, you do the adjustment for this purification step, and you go to the stepwise gradient. So now instead of having a linear gradient, you go to the first step, which is removing some of your impurities, the next step where your phage is eluting, and then the next step where DNA is eluting. And when you do this, you obtain very nice results on the small scale column, which 54% recovery of your phage, and you see that in one single chromatography step, you remove 90% of the protein impurities and more than 99% of DNA impurities. Then, before going to a large scale, of course, you need to know what is the binding capacity of your material, because you would not like to do this on large scale, you need to do it on a small scale, otherwise you lose too much of your material. And dynamic binding capacity is done very simply, chromatographically, very simply. You just load your sample with a known concentration and with a known flow rate through the column, and you check when this material is not binding to the column any longer, when it is in the flow through. So up to here, this was done with no problems. Phage was completely binding. No phage was found in the flow through. So based on this information, based on this data, the binding capacity was determined to be 1.1 to the 10th of the 10 particles per milliliter. Then you do the washing step, of course, and then the elution, and your phage is here. But now you know how much of the material you can load to your larger column. And then the next step was the scaling up to the 8 milliliter column, so a 25-fold scaling up. And 20% of the maximum column capacity was loaded. So not the complete capacity, but only 20% because of the things which were behind, so the amount of sample which was needed. Bacterial lysate was diluted two times, and it was directly loaded on the column at the flow rate of 30 milliliter per minute, so keeping the same linear velocity as it was on a small scale, and the results were much, much similar as on a small scale. 65% of phage recovery in one step, 10% only proteins, so 90% removal of proteins, and 99% removal of host cell DNA. So when you compare the results on a small scale and larger scale, I would not say this is a large scale, but maybe larger scale, you see very similar parameters were obtained. And these columns come in different formats, different volumes, from 1 ml to 8 liter. And this is the amount of phages you can purify in a single step on these different columns. So you can imagine already how much electric power you can generate with these phages purified on a large monolithic column. So we can say scaling up is not a challenge any longer. We are not using the word problem. We are trying to avoid this and using a challenge. But in these days in Brussels, I realized that maybe here with all these beers which are around, is not so much problematic the scaling up, but the biodiversity. It's very difficult to pick up the right beer, so. And just for conclusions, very briefly, a single step purification of this phage was developed on strong anion exchange monolithic column with 90% of proteins and 99% of host cell DNA removed in a single step. 60%, let's say, in general, of viable phage was recovered. The column, the method was developed on a small scale, transferred to larger scale. Then the transfer to even larger scale would be very straightforward, just factor by 10. And the dynamic binding capacity was determined, which was very high. And some general conclusions, these monolithic columns can be useful not only for phages, but for many, many different viruses. There are now 35 projects in clinical phase 1 to clinical phase 3 trials, and more than 200 projects in preclinical trials with some phages and some other viruses. And just about a few words, BIA Separations was founded in 1998, and we are now headquartered in Austria, but R&D and production are still in Slovenia. In 2007, we opened sales and tech support office in the States, and in 2011 in China. And our main focus is really to develop and sell columns, but also to develop methods and purification processes of phages or other viruses, so we can do both. In October 2011, we just moved to a new facility, which is in nice Vipava Valley. We have like 4,000 square meters facility. We also have rooms for guests, so people who would like to come and work in our company are more than welcome, can stay there for a couple of days, weeks, or even months. And to acknowledge, of course, people from Viridax Corporation who supplied us with the phage, for the National Institute of Biology who did this electron microscopy, for people from BIA Separations that did most of the work of the experiments, and former people from BIA Separations that are now at Center of Excellence, Matyash and Dalej, and who are now in Jeffrel, like Francis Mecker. And with this, I would like to thank you very much. And of course, if there are any questions, I would be happy to answer you. Thank you very much.